thanks and praise for this new day. We give you thanks and praise for life, for hope, for joy, and peace. Accept our prayers, praises, and our offerings as we start our service here this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. The hymn for the procession. We'll begin our morning prayer on page 32. Book of Common Prayer. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty for all that is in the heaven and in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. I will put my spirit within you and make you follow my statutes and be careful to observe my ordinances. On page 35, either one. Blessed be the Lord our God.
By his grace we are yet alive.
Blessed be his Son, Jesus Christ.
By whose rising we are set free.
Blessed be the Spirit of God.
In whom is our hope and our joy.
We will move to the Jubilate, which is in the insert. And this is after the prayer. Let us pray. Page 36. Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer you our worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship bear witness to your peace and saving power. Through your Spirit, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
psalm appointed is Psalm 33, verses 1 to 12, which will be sung.
Lord, we pray to you for the forgiveness of our sins. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first reading.
From the Word of God, written in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 9. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kingship and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you, make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the ones who curse you I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Haran went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Haran was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Haran took his wife Sarai and his brother's son Lot and all the possession that they had gathered and the people who had acquired in Haran. And they set forth to the land of Canaan. And when they had come to the land of Canaan, Aram passed through the land to the place of Shechem and to the oak of Moriah. And that time the Canaanites were in the land, and the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring I will give you this land. So he built there an altar to the Lord, who had appeared to him. From there he moved on to the hill country of the east of Bethel and pitched his tent, which Bethel was on the west and Hai on the east, and he built an altar to the Lord and invoked the name of the Lord. And Haran journeyed on by stage towards Nahab. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans, chapter 4, verses 13 to 25. The promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations, in the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said. So numerous shall your descendants be. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to Christ, our Savior. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up and followed him. And as he sat at dinner in the house, many tax collectors and sinners came and were sitting with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to the disciples,
"Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" But when he heard this, he said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners." While he was saying these things to them, suddenly a leader of the synagogue came in and knelt before him, saying, "My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her, and she will live." And Jesus got up and followed him with his disciples. Then suddenly, a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak. For she said to herself, "If only I touch his cloak, I will be made well." Jesus turned, and seeing her, he said, "Take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well." And instantly, the woman was made well. When Jesus came to the leader's house and saw the flute players and the crowd making a commotion, he said, "Go away, for the girl is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. But when the crowd had been put outside, he went in and took her by the hand, and the girl got up. And the report of this spread throughout the district. The word of the Lord.
We stand and reaffirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed as we say together. As we say together, "I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand.
Suffrage this morning, Form A and page 43. Lord, reveal your love among us,
that we may know the joy of your salvation.
Grant peace within and among all nations,
and teach our leaders wisdom.
Endow your church with faithfulness,
and your servants with knowledge and true godliness.
Defend, O Lord, the rights of the poor and the oppressed,
that your justice may be known among all people.
Lord, we thank you for those celebrating birthday today. For this week, Ashley Campbell, Everett Grant, Dudley Murphy, and Raheem Hemmings. O Lord, comfort those who mourn. And here we remember the family of Reverend Canon George Thomas. For those celebrating anniversaries, Mr. Calvin Hunter and Mrs. Debbie Hunter. O Lord, we bring before you those who are sick and the shut-in. Lord, be a source of comfort and strength to them, we pray this morning. Lord, renew your spirit within us,
that in us and through us your will may be done.
grant that by your inspiration, we may think those things that are right and do those things that are good. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, the lover of unity, the author of peace, to know you is perfect freedom. To serve you is eternal life. Defend us from your servants, from the assault of the enemy, that we may trust in your defense and not fear the power of the adversary. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord God, Almighty and Everlasting Father, you have brought us in safety to a new day. Preserve us with your mighty power, that we may not fall, may not be overcome by our sins and our adversities, that we may do those things that are fulfilling in your sight. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The hymn for the offertory is number 5. For the office thing, not the offertory, my apologies. Good morning, my sisters and brothers. May the word of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be now and always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. This is the second Sunday after Pentecost, and we say a special prayer. Thank you, dear Father, for being our God. We know that our God is always on time. Our God doesn't waste time. Our God makes time and teaches us what it looks like to make good use of our time on this earth. Our time is limited, therefore our time must be managed. Our time is out of our hands to the point where we must pause for our spiritual health's sake to remember who our time falls under. Our time under God is time well spent. Under God, we recognize how God is helping us through our weakness. Our time under God puts rest and self-care into perspective. Amen. From our reading this morning, we have to proclaim, who are we? And as we think about today's lessons, and we ask, we look at God's function. God has changed us. We look at how much we allow God to penetrate and grow within us, and how we are demonstrating the presence of God in our lives through our action. The gospel reading highlighted text from Matthew chapter 9. It included Jesus' call of Matthew, the tax collector, as well as two accounts of healing. One, a woman who had been suffering for some time, and the other, a child who had died. Jesus walks by Matthew's tax office, and he saw Matthew sitting at his desk at the tax collector's booth, and he invited Matthew to become part of his team. He said, "Follow me." And Matthew got up and followed him. Not only did Matthew go with Jesus, but he must have introduced Jesus to all his tax collecting friends. Because as the next verse says, Jesus and his disciples had dinner that night with all sorts of tax collectors and sinners. The Jewish religious leaders of Capernaum are stunned. They see Jesus, this supposed religious man, sitting at the dinner table with the most corrupt and sinful people that they enable are, and who were laughing and drinking wine and carrying on. Some of them may even have been talking inappropriately. So the Jews asked Jesus' disciples why in the world their leader would do such a thing, sitting and eating with all these sinners. Jesus heard what had been said, the question that had been asked, and he said to them, "Those who are healthy don't need a doctor. The sick need a doctor. So go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have not come into the world to call the righteous, but to call the sinners. And the next account, one of the rulers came to Jesus and our Lord arose and followed him, and also his disciples. So Matthew had followed Jesus, and he also followed Jesus to the house of the ruler. And much of the account is firsthand, and it is Matthew alone of the evangelists who mentioned the minstrels. By the time they got to the house, the child had started to recover. And in the reading, Matthew tells us of two of the miracles that Jesus performed. The first, a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhage for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringes of his cloak. For she said, "If only I touch his cloak, I will be made well." Jesus turned and seeing her, he said, "Take heart, daughter. Your faith has made you well." And instantly she was made well. This poor woman who had initially interrupted the journey to the ruler's home had been suffering for over 12 years. She was poor both out of sympathy of her condition and because she had actually spent all of her substances seeing ineffectual doctors, as recorded in Mark chapter 5, verse 26. This serves as a contrast to God's healing of this lady. With she touching Jesus is theoretically a poor condition because it rendered Jesus ceremoniously unclean. Yet Jesus is willing to reach out and touch us or to be touched, whatever our infirmities are. His words to the woman are very reassuring to those of us who hardly dare approach him. What he said to her, "Take heart, daughter, for your faith has healed you." It is interesting to note that Jesus addressed the woman as a daughter, his daughter. Rulers and outcasts are all made one in Jesus Christ, as reported in Galatians chapter 3, verse 28. And God is the Father of us all, so he is in fact our Father, and we are his daughters and sons. The second case, the leader of the synagogue came in and knelt before Jesus saying, "My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her and she will live." She was 12 years old, so she was the same age as the medical condition that the woman had been experiencing, 12 years. So Jesus went to the leader's house And when he entered the synagogue leader's house and saw and heard the noisy crowd and people who were playing pipes, he asked them to go away. He said to them, "The girl is not dead, but she is asleep." But they laughed at him. However, after the crowd had been put outside, he went in and took the girl by the hand, and she got up. And her healing has been made available to all members of that region. In this particular section, Matthew presents us with a story within a story. As you might expect, with such a literary device, there are both similarities with the stories and there are some dissimilarities. And the similarity was that both had shown faith in Christ. And as a result, this resulted in their healing. So we need to show our faith in Christ if we're ill so that we can be healed. Also included in Matthew chapter 9, but which wasn't read this morning, Jesus' healing of a paralyzed man and his treatment of two blind men and a man who was muted. And as a result of their faith, they were restored to normal. So we have to bear in mind that we have to have faith in Christ so that we can be healed. These stories may seem a bit unrelated, but the overarching theme of the power of God's life to change people connects them. Jesus interacts with, eats with, and touches those who are regarded as unclean, untouchable. His life and love cures the sickness, both spiritual and physical, and those who are in need of healing. We as Christians ought to accept the authority of Jesus Christ as he has suggested to his disciples to drive and impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. As Christians and representatives of the religious community, we have the opportunity to participate in pastoral care, to visit and care for members of our church and community so as to enable them to recover from their illnesses. See, we think we are the religious ones because we are in church. We are the ones with high moral character and good values and deep convictions. And in comparison with the rest of the world, we really are. We smell pretty religious. We shine up pretty good on Sunday mornings, as we are today here in church. And since we're known by the company we keep, we like to hang around with people who look very much like us, know us, and are our religious members. Jesus is called to be his disciples, people who by all considerations, appear to be completely unequipped or unqualified to hold such responsibilities. However, it means that following Jesus has to do with his grace towards us, not our ability to get the job done. Jesus has the full authority of heaven in his very bones, but he chooses not to use it to judge us. He chooses to use such authority to bless us, to offer compassion and grace to us. But then we are judged if we do not accept his grace. The good news is that Jesus is willing to keep company with us anyway. In fact, he chooses to keep company with us despite, or maybe precisely because of our indebtedness. And wherever you find Jesus keeping company, you find him offering forgiveness. And so, Father, forgive our debt and give us the courage and insight to forgive the debt of others so that we can accept your divine grace towards us, that we may help one another in their illnesses. And this we ask in your name's sake. Amen. Thank you.
Together we stand and pray the prayer of dedication. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our path, and a strength to our lives. Brothers and sisters, the kingdom of God is justice, peace, and joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit. The peace of the Lord be always with you. The hymn for the offertory, 445. Father, we offer to you these gifts which you have given us, this bread, this wine, this money. We offer to you our souls and our world. And through your Holy Spirit,
the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father Almighty, everlasting God. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to be your people. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Eucharistic prayer form B. Holy and gracious Father, all creation rightly gives you praise. All life, all holiness comes from you, through your Son Jesus Christ, whom you sent to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. We therefore bring you these gifts, and we ask you to make them holy by the power of your Holy Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, who offered himself in obedience to your will, to the whole, as a perfect sacrifice for all humankind. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take this and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup of wine,
And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of our faith. Father, calling to mind the death your Son endured for our salvation, his glorious resurrection and ascension, his continual intercession for us in heaven, and looking for his coming again in glory, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and life-giving sacrifice. Look with favor on your church's offering, and grant that we who eat and drink of these holy gifts may be filled with your Holy Spirit and be one body and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. May he make us a perpetual offering to you and enable us in communion with Blessed Mary, Saint Matthew, and all your company of heaven to share in the eternal inheritance of your saints. With him and in him and through him, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father Almighty, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor, hallelujah. Glory and honor, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. As our Savior has taught us, so we pray.
Thy kingdom come.
This is the true bread which comes from heaven. Beloved, the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
the second of our post-communion prayers. Eternal God and Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of our mission song, we will have our walk of collection.
My brothers and sisters, good morning.
Good morning.
The notices for this week. Birthday greetings are extended to Ashley Campbell, Everett Grant, Dudley Murphy, and Raheem Hemmings. Anniversary greetings to Mr. Calvin Hunter and Mrs. Debbie Hunter. We extend condolences to the family of Reverend Canon George Thomas, who died. Please uphold them in your prayers. Important dates to remember: Father's Day, June 18. Deanery Sunday, June 25, and this will be held at St. Peter's Church, Port Royal. Missionary Sunday, Missionary Service, July 9th, July 7th to 14th, Diocesan Summer Camp, Juniors, ages 8 to 12, and the camp for the ages 6 to 17, July 10 to 21. July 28th, the Women's Auxiliary will be having a takeaway supper. This afternoon at 4 p.m., there will be a Corpus Christi service at St. Luke's Church in Crossroads. This service is particularly for the acolytes, who are the altar servers, the lay readers, and the chalice bearers. This morning, immediately after service, the women's auxiliary will be having a porridge sale. I think it's hominy corn porridge. The cost for each cup is $300. Please support the women's auxiliary. Father's Day celebration, as I said before, June 18th. Confirmation classes are about to begin. Persons interested in being confirmed are asked to give their names to Sister Mary. Music camp for ages 6 to 17 will be held on July 10th to July 21st at Christchurch Vineyard Town between the hours of 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. Participants will be exposed to choral music, drumming, steel pan, guitar, and the recorder. The cost is $14,000 for each person. And as I said before, the diocesan summer camp costs will be $12,000 for those who register early, $15,000 for those who register late. Beg your pardon?
Early bird deadline is June
28th. The early bird deadline, so the deadline for you to get the $12,000 registration ends on June 28th. So until June 28th, if you register on or before, you'll pay $12,000 for each child. After that, it will be $15,000 for each child. I take this opportunity to advise the congregation that Father Craig Mears has been given an extension to be with us until December of this year. Brothers and sisters, those are the notices for this morning, this week. Thank you.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. The Spirit of truth lead you into all truth, and to give you grace to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Our recessional hymn as printed in our leaflet.
Thank you.
Let us pray.